Yeah, we kind of talk about just like how you grew up around it and like your perception of it when you were younger. Like I grew up just like watching my dad or my mom like grab logs and stuff and throw it around the fire. So I was like, oh, it's just a fire, you know? You can like kind of touch it and stuff. And then like if you're quick, my dad would say, as long as you're quick, you can just throw it around. It doesn't matter. It kind of depends on like that. So I still think that they're just like cool, awesome, crazy things. That's how I always saw them as a kid and was.
Yeah.
Taught that they're just like, oh yeah, crazy fire.
It definitely seems like it depends on personal experience, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Like I've never had any crazy house burning down situation. Mm-hmm. So it's like yeah.
Any last thoughts? Yeah. We talked a little bit about just like how media plays an effect on your perception of fire, and like I know I did. I took class in the fall where I focused a lot on watching different Disney films and how they perceive fire and like how that's influenced just kind of like what we all think of fire is. Like you think of like Bambi and how like fire is like super destructive, and that was like capitalized and Bambi was like used for different ads, and like how like it starts to make up this image that like when there's a forest fire, like all the like you're killing all these animals and like only you're the one that can prevent it, and just kind of like how that plays into it all.
Yeah, no, that's a really good point.
I guess we talked about transformation and fire as a catalyst to change, new growth.
For sure. Yeah, I definitely feel, for me, I get like a sense of both. Like, I love campfires and the smell of it brings back so many good memories, but then I've also had, I know people who've lost lives in house fires, and so it's really traumatizing to hear about these big forest fires destroying these homes. Just because it's so relatable and so, I guess, stark, yeah.
I also was thinking about, too, how, like, I feel like thinking back to what we were taught about, like, the beginning of the modern human, like, started with fire,
yeah.
And that's, like, always talked about is, like, the central point of, like, how, like, modernization and, like, using fire to burn things, to move things that create energy, or, like, how it talked about as this like central thing that started this big
innovation.
Yeah, innovation and modernization.
Yeah, itself has gone through a lot of change. This area used to be burned to grow camas, right? And so it didn't look like this at all, and a lot of the Doug firs have taken over a lot of the island, and as Chris was saying in his presentation, gary oaks were really common here, and the Doug firs are pushing them out. So you see an ecosystem change here without those fires and with fire suppression. On Yellow Island, which I believe is on the other side of Orcas, it's south of here, they're doing controlled burns right now, and so they're looking at it as an experiment and seeing how it grows back. And so while I was reading all of that, I was trying to imagine that happening here. Like, what would it look like? It's so much more, the trees and the bushes are much more grown than they are on Yellow Island. I was watching videos and it's mostly grass and some trees that they'll burn around. So that's something to think about. Fire suppression, it's really interesting to think about humans controlling it because they're managing that island, and so in a way, is that a natural way to control it? Something I think about a lot. I was also reading that when you control a fire, if you make fire lines, the fire often doesn't penetrate deep into the soil, so these first species in succession are able to grow back. Like camas is one of the first in succession to grow. But if you make fire lines, you dig into the soil, and they've seen that it doesn't grow back because you're taking these roots out. Or it does, but it takes a lot longer. So you have this break in the forest where they dug that line. And in forests like this, I think that Doug fir generally can withstand about 30 years between the fires. And so fire regimes is basically how frequently ecosystems need fires. And so it's different from species to species. I don't quite remember what it is for gary oaks, but one that we saw here, lodgepole pines. I have an example of these. So these trees need a certain amount of fire in order to germinate, and their natural speed, I guess. So they can still germinate, and they do that by opening their cones. And while it still happens without fire. It happens a lot slowly, a lot more slowly and gradually than it would if fires were more frequent here. So I have an example of cones that were open, and I was going to open them at the fire, but I forgot to do it. But it's a good example of you don't need fire to open them. It can still happen, but, and then this one's a closed cone. So, and basically these cones are called serotonous cones, and that means that you need an environmental trigger to open them and for them to germinate. And in this case, fire. And I was trying to find other examples, but most of them were just fire, so.
Could it also be like an animal opening them, or is that a different
thing? I think it could be. I'm not sure.
I think serotonin means just fire.
Just fire?
Yeah, or heat.
Yeah. Mm.
So really, really hot, warm days will open the cone. But you said it right, that they open a lot more slowly. Mm. Some serotonous cones actually explode.
Mm.
And they'll go bing, and all the bracts will happen, and the seeds go bing.
One thing to look at is, since this area does not have fire, a lot of the shrubs are able to grow, and they a lot of times will grow tall or up trees. And so if you were to have a fire here now, it would look a lot different than if you had camas grass and gary oaks. A lot of trees are very durable in fire. Douglas firs specifically have very thick bark that protects the inner layers of the bark. As we were walking here, you saw a lot of fire scars. And so those just touched the tree, but the trees didn't burn down. While some may have, the ones that are still up are still here, and they survived through that fire. So what do you think it would look like now if it were, like, if this island were to have a fire? What do you think it would look like compared to back then? Like, before and after? Yeah.
Because of the amount of understory growth there is, all those Doug firs aren't probably going to be able to survive these fires because their branches aren't flame retardant, it's just the bark.
Mm-hmm.
So like, there's probably going to be, it would be a very big town fire, and like,
yeah.
All, like, I feel like the entire island would just go up in flames.
Yeah.
Almost.
Definitely be very destructive to what's going
on. I have a question.
Yes.
Do fires just naturally end on their own?
They can, yes, they can. If there's a lot of fuel, they'll probably keep going for a lot longer, but with big forest fires, like the one, somebody mentioned it, it was the Bridge of the Gods one, which is a scenic byway on the Oregon-Washington border, kind of in the middle of the state, and that area burned down this summer because of fireworks, and that one kept going. And then there are smaller ones, like there was one in Larrabee this summer while I was working, and it only reached 66 acres. So it really depends. Yeah. So a BioBlitz is a citizen science program that I think a lot of national parks use, where the, and I think Vashon Island as well, their nature center does this every year, where they bring community members in to be citizen scientists. And it's basically where you go and you try to find as many species as you can around the area, and it's a way of mapping what's there. And the idea is that you don't have to be a scientist to observe and notice things. And a lot of times scientists will expect things to be a certain way, and so they'll view it a lot differently than citizens would, who maybe don't know the systems of the area or what's in the area. So we're gonna do a little modification of that, and we're going to, in groups of two or three, go around and look for evidence of fire, and then come back and see what we found. And honestly, anything relating to fire, that's just like the main prompt. And so there's examples of lodgepole pines and gary oaks and camas and just kind of what a controlled burn looks like. And definitely branch out from these are just to give you an idea of some of the things I talked about. So. Yes.
Quick question, how do you spell serotonous?
S-E-R-O-T-I-N-O-U-S.
Can you say that?
Oh yeah. S-E-R-O-T-I-N-O-U-S. And it's on the paper too, that I'll hand around. Does anyone have any questions before we do that?
Which means the fire came
from this direction.
What, that's north? Huh? Is that north?
Fire always burns north. Well, also, it didn't get very high.
Oh my goodness. That is so yummy.
I do have a compass.
Wait, is it raining?
Yeah, no. It's starting to rain, yeah.
I don't want to put on my rain fan.
Minutes, what did everybody find or notice?
We found a bird cage.
Yeah.
And around it was a lot of this stuff.
Yeah. And we believe around it was a form of secondary succession, a primary species with intermediate popping up.
In those terms in there.
Yeah.
We found a madrone that was like partially open, and it definitely had blackened inside, but we weren't sure if it was parasite or if it was like fire scar. Is that what you call it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we don't. No.
Notice how the trees were usually just burned on one side.
Yeah. That's one thing I wanted to bring up that I forgot to mention earlier is that there are patterns in wildfires and fires in general. So when you have a big wildfire, you'll have fire investigators come in. And this summer I met them at Larrabee, and they were saying that they look for patterns, and you can tell which way it's going by the patterns on the trees or bushes that survive, which is really interesting. So that may be a reason why all of the scars are on one side of the tree, or on one side of all the trees. If you noticed when we were coming, it was just a small patch, not around it. So, yeah.
I had a question. So say a fire is headed uphill this way, would the scar be on the side that's facing us or on the opposite side?
I am not sure, but I would assume on the side that it's going, because as it goes through, it'll catch that side, but then kind of go
past that.
Be like a break, jump. Right?
Yeah.
So it'll hit the tree, it'll burn on this side, and then it'll go like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then it'll eventually come back.
It's like water, but flame.
Water, but a totally other element.
Yeah. Wrap your mind around that.
Yeah.
Water. Watery flame.
Steam. Also, a fun fact with the, since I think we need to keep going, with the perceptions of fire, when, I don't know how many of you have heard of Michael Pollan's book, I don't remember what it's called, but he wrote a book about how people cook or like gather food with all four elements. And I was watching the show and there was the fire one, and there's a culture, a community, and I think, I don't know, it's somewhere in Africa, but they will light the shrub on fire and it draws this giant lizard to the top, and you can see where it is in the ground, and they pull the tail out, and that's their meat.
Aborigine, it's Australia.
Australia, thank you. Which is really interesting. Mm. So another way to look at it as a source of
So just one little ecological hint around the arbutus and those black openings. So that's called canker, and it is a parasitic fungus. There's lots of different types of canker, and this is the most cankerous part of the island. You'll see just this arbutus right here. You can see its little cankers on it right there, and also there it looks like blisters at the bottom.
Right.
Just look at your arbutus. There's one across that's very light orange. It's starting to die. You see all the cankers on it. And by the time we get to the other end, you'll see a lot of cankerous. I don't know if that's how you're supposed to say it, but it seems right. That's how you would say it if it was on your face. So, all arbutus all along this area. And it's part of the disease that's affecting a lot of the arbutuses right now. And so part of why that arbutus right there is partially dead is likely because of that canker.
Yeah.